Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And what I'd like to do in this lecture is to, in effect, look at the negative side of our conference, which is, on the positive side, it's trying to explore ways of thinking about divine action. What I thought might be helpful to do is to ask, why is there resistance to it? What are the problems? I want to try and tease out a number of things that seem to me to be interesting. And what I want to do, really, is to just look at some of the cultural background, which I think helps set the scene. And it's not simply we're looking at the past as if this were, you know, something that is dead and gone. I mean, this lingers, this remains with us as an essential referent in our ongoing discussions about this matter. And so I want to focus on from about 1650 to 1800, but most of the ideas I'll be looking at, I think, really are things that we are very familiar with as everyday realities affecting this discussion. And I'm not going to talk about miracles for the very simple reason that so many are, but obviously this would be part of this discussion. But I think it's fair to say that to avoid duplication, we'll just leave that to others to talk about. So it might be good just to remind ourselves that Ian Ramsey, who was a very well-known philosopher of religion here at Oxford some time ago, actually spoke about this theme in his book Models for Divine Activity. And it's quite a short book, but actually it does raise some very interesting questions, I think. The book goes back to the early 1970s, and he's reflecting rather unhappily on the present state of theology. He was a philosophical theologian, in fact a predecessor of Richard Swinburne, and wrote, "Theology is a present in turmoil." And if I were asked to characterize our present discontents, I think I would select two features as basic to the present scene. First, there is a loss of a sense of God's presence. And secondly, there's a growing inability to see the point of theological discourse. Now, maybe that second one remains with us. That first one, I think, is very interesting. Because in the book, what he's arguing, really, is that the palpable sense of God's presence, which may be characterized earlier discussion of this question, seems to have gone within the West. And that actually is a predisposition against thinking about divine activity at all. And he's concerned about this development, and he writes some things which I think are helpful. He writes, "We're on our way to a theological atheism if we think," and I quote, "that talk about God's activity is only figurative and picturesque." And in this very interesting but very short book, Ramsey begins to map out what he thinks might be, if not a road to recovery, then at least a road towards the beginnings of recovery. And interestingly, he sees a way ahead in a renewed interest in the Holy Spirit. And I'll come back to that later in this lecture. But what I want to do is to offer you three major angles of approach to this question. The question being, why is there this cultural suspicion about the whole idea of special divine action, or indeed actually divine action at all? And I want to offer these three angles of approach as simply being illuminating. There are many other things I think that could be said, but these I think begin to give us a framework for understanding some of these points. First of all, I think it's very clear that the increasingly rationalist culture of this period, that's about 1650 to 1800, clearly created a prejudice against the idea of special divine action. Then secondly, again a theme that would be picked up, I'm sure, by others, that the growing emphasis, which we see in the late 17th, early 18th century, on the lawlike behaviour of the natural world, creates anxiety about the notion of special divine action, because this appears to be possibly erratic. It contravenes the frameworks of regularity, which are beginning to become embedded in discussions of this theme. And obviously I'll be expanding on this to make the point clearer. But again, this seems to be an issue that's lingering in the background to our discussion. And a third theme is more explicitly theological. And that is that many theologians of this earlier age were apprehensive about the rationality of the doctrine of the Trinity. Very often this is downplayed in Christian apologetics of the late 17th, early 18th centuries. It's seen as being something that is rationally questionable, but also actually having no obvious utility value. And I want to suggest that the recovery of thinking about the Trinity actually feeds very positively into our discussions of this theme. Now, obviously, these ideas flow together, and I'm simply singling them out, separating them out to make discussion easier. But let's, I think, begin with the first of them, the rise of rationalism. I think I want to emphasize the point that I'm not simply talking about the intellectual world. I'm talking about a broader cultural framework. I'm trying to ask, why has our culture come to regard this with suspicion? I think we do need to realize that actually this is not simply an intellectual development, there are cultural pressures going on. And we might think, obviously, of the wars of religion, especially the 30 Years' War, which I think created intense irritation against religion in the sense that religion seemed to generate conflict without offering means of resolution. In other words, tensions between Catholicism and Protestantism were really quite serious. There was no universally accepted religious criteria by which disputes might be adjudicated, obviously raising the question, is there something beyond religion which allows us to resolve these issues without, in effect, ending up in religious wars? And we might tease out three phases in this development. The first phase, which I think you can see in the late 17th century, is to say that, look, Christianity is fundamentally a rational religion, so let's kind of accentuate the rational dimensions. While at the same time saying, look, revelation, we're okay about that, but it doesn't offer anything exclusive in that reason ought to be able to find its way to these conclusions without the need for revelation in the first place. And you might say it's a kind of soft rationalism, but it hardens up really quite quickly. Because the second phase of this trend, which you find in Tyndall and various English deist writers, is to say, look, Christianity is basically rational, that there's really not any need for revelation at all. Christianity is the republication, to use Tyndall's famous phrase, of the religion of nature. And that, I think, is again a significant development, but it's the third trend, which I think many of us find most interesting. And that is, in effect, the growing emphasis. Well, it's not just, you know, that reason and revelation are equally useful. Actually, it is reason which is in the position of being able to judge revelation. And you'll find this in Thomas Paine's Age of Reason. And the point here is that revelation is not simply being declared to be potentially redundant, but potentially revisable, correctable, in the light of a resource which is seen as actually carrying greater weight. And of course, that is reason itself. And I think that you can see that that does tend to lead towards a cultural predisposition to see the notion of special divine action as being irrational or unreasonable. And we might gloss that phrase irrational as in effect being out of sync with contemporary meta-narratives of divine action. In other words, there's an expectation beginning to emerge of what this ought to be like. And I'll come to this more in our second point, but that's a very significant development where in effect, perhaps for reasons that are as intuitive as much as rational, there's a growing feeling that this sort of thing just doesn't happen. And I'm not talking about miracles, but you can see how, for example, Diderot's critique of miracles and testimonial grounds fits into that rather nicely. But there's a cultural issue here, which I think we need to emphasize. And really, it's not simply why is there this intellectual suspicion about this, but why is there this broader cultural predisposition against this? And if we understand how that emerged, is there any way in which we might try to change that cultural predisposition in our own time? And that seems to me to be an important point to discuss. And I thought I'd bring in here a very obvious dialogue partner, and that's Charles Taylor's book, A Secular Age, which came out about 7 years ago. And it seems to me it just gives us a useful framework for beginning to think about these issues. And Taylor is really concerned to explain why on a whole series of issues relating to the question of God, including the one under discussion in this conference, there has been such a significant change in the last 500 years. Why, Taylor asks, was it virtually impossible not to believe in God in, say, 1500, while in 2000, many of us find this not only easy, but even inescapable. He's talking there about disbelief in God. And his argument is that there's been a shift in master narratives, especially those embedded in social institutions, from 1500 to the present day. And as many of you will know, he uses this language of an imminent frame as a way of describing this growing consensus that he sees within culture. And he argues that this is perhaps helpful as an understanding of why our culture has moved in such a secular direction. And he argues there are a number of features that you could tease out as being part of this, and therefore part of the explanation for this cultural change we've seen. For example, a sharp distinction between the natural and the supernatural, between the divine and the human, so that making sense of the world around us now seem to be possible in terms of this world alone. I think Taylor's point there is important. Making sense of the world around us in terms of this world alone. In other words, you have increasingly a closed system emerging from which there is really no way in which God is able to break back in. Now, Taylor uses the language of disengagement, where Max Weber tended to use the language of disenchantment. And actually, I quite like Taylor's use at this point, because he's in effect talking about the generation of attitudes towards the natural world, which in effect involve a crystallizing, sometimes intuitive understanding of what is going on there. And Taylor's point is that as a result of this shift in master narrative, nature has become emptied of the spirits or the signs or the cosmic purposes that once seemed to be a fact of everyday experience. And if you've read books on late medieval religion, for example, Stripping the Altars, you'll know that this kind of pervasive sense of the presence of divinity in nature actually seems to have been commonplace back in the late 14th, early 15th, early 16th century. And there clearly has been some sort of change going on by which nature came to be conceived fundamentally as an impersonal order of matter and force governed by causal laws. Now, Weber and Taylor are saying very similar things, but Taylor's emphasis, I think, is slightly different. And Taylor talks about a shift to what he called closed world structures. It's a good phrase, and actually it's a phrase which I think just illuminates the issue we're dealing with in thinking about special divine action. And we see these closed world structures that assume what Taylor calls an immanent frame in beliefs such as, and to stand out to me as being especially relevant for our purposes here, first of all, that natural events are now just seen as natural events. They are no longer naturally to be seen as acts of God. So in effect, what we're talking about, well, I suppose you might say, is theory-laden observation, to use Hansen's phrase, and previously you would bring a lens which said these actions are God's, you'd now bring a different lens which says these are just to be understood within the matrix of the world itself, a closed world structure approach. Or again, nature's become disenchanted, reduced to the predictable and quantifiable. And that's relevant, but I think the first of these points really affects our discussions here in this lecture. And Taylor's concern, he's trying to register his own anxiety about what he sees happening, is that our age suffers from a threatened loss of meaning. And he uses this very interesting language about a buffered identity. This malaise, he writes, is specific to a buffered identity whose very invulnerability opens it to the danger that not just evil spirits or cosmic forces or gods won't get to it, but that nothing significant will stand out for it. To unpack that a little bit, Taylor is concerned that this closed world structure, which in effect references nature with reference to nature, is in effect in a position where it excludes certain forces, but makes it very, very difficult to identify anything within that closed world structure as being of potential significance. But it's really the sociological aspect of this which I think we need to reflect on. How did this narrative, this meta-narrative, achieve social dominance? And Taylor argues that closed world structures now, I quote, function as unchallenged axioms in Western culture. In other words, a mindset has emerged which is predisposed to see these things this way, almost as a default position. And it's not that there's really a debate about this. This has become a settled opinion. And to unsettle it, we've got to think not simply about the intellectual issues, but how you challenge a dominant narrative in this way. And Taylor obviously is not dealing with SDA in great detail in this book, but nevertheless he does argue that the whole idea of divine action is a classic example of something that is being squeezed out, declared to be irrational because of the hegemony of this particular master narrative. Now Taylor himself, I think, distances himself from Weber at a number of points. He argues for an open interpretation of this imminent frame where he sees Weber as endorsing a more closed reading. But I think the real issue is that Taylor is quite clear that there is room for what he calls intellectual maneuver within the imminent frame. My understanding, he writes, of the imminent frame is that properly understood, it allows both readings without compelling us to either. In other words, Taylor is saying there is conceptual and cultural space for the rehabilitation of such ideas as divine action, even though they may not be the most natural interpretations given our cultural mindset. But the word natural there really has a sense of self-evident within the context of that master narrative. So I think there are issues to look at here. Again, if we want to challenge this, we do need to understand how it arose. How did this imminent frame emerge and gain this cultural authority, this cultural hegemony, to use the language of Gramsci? And Taylor argues, I think entirely predictably and probably quite rightly, that it lies in part through the scientific revolution. When nature came to be conceived fundamentally as an impersonal order of matter and force governed by causal laws. And he argues that this conception of nature itself flows naturally from this new attitude towards the world that Taylor calls disengagement, which he frames in terms of a distancing outlook of the buffered self. And you may feel the language is a little bit elaborate, but I think it's fairly clear what he's trying to get at. It's best seen, I think, by looking at this question about God and the laws of nature, which is the second major angle of approach that I want to take. And we're looking here at what is, I think, sometimes unhelpfully called the rise of the mechanical worldview, seen, for example, in Newtonian laws of motion. And at the time, of course, this met with cultural resistance. The idea of disenchantment, namely that we reduce the world to these forces, to quantifiable aspects of nature, met resistance from people like, well, William Blake, you know, who talked about Newton as being sheathed in dismal steel. And you might also think of Goethe, or you might think indeed of Keats's poem Lamia, which talks about reducing the vibrancy of nature to the dull catalogue of common themes. And the analogy of God as the divine clockmaker, you find in Robert Boyle, the analogy of the great clock at Strasbourg. and all of these are there. What's the relevance? Well, I think the key point to accentuate is this regularity of nature. God acted in the past to create a well-designed and reliable machine. It now functions on its own as an autonomous mechanism whose regularities are open to investigation and representation mathematically without the need for divine interference. And of course, you might think of Pope's famous epitaph, "Nature and nature's laws lay hid in night. God said, let Newton be, and all was light." But I think the point I want to really emphasize here is that this growing emphasis on the regularity of nature, which is especially associated with natural sciences, created the expectation that God governed the world indirectly through regularity and law. And therefore, there was some reluctance to allow special divine action in that this was seen to be potentially contravening this framework of regularity. And we do, I think, need to be aware of the social framework against which this whole discussion is set. And one example that might help us understand this is, why is it that no mainline Protestant wrote a book commenting on the book of Revelation between about 1520 and 1550? And the answer many historians would give is because it was just too unsettling. It seemed to suggest the possibility of divine redirection or radical change within the existing social order. And that, I think, is a fear that is very much there. It's certainly true that Catholic apologetics in England during the Marian period tended to focus on the miraculous, whereas during later Protestant periods, actually the miraculous seemed not to be expected at all. The growing emphasis on natural theology, in effect, seems to suggest that God won't necessarily do anything, but we can, in effect, infer his existence from the regularity of a non-interfered with structure within nature. So I think we might suggest that there may be social reasons that lie behind this emphasis on the regularity of nature. For example, you all read Margaret Jacobs' reflections on Newtonian-based natural theology, arguing that in some way this reflects a desire for stability in a period which had been characterized by a lot of instability. What I think is interesting is just to note how a growing emphasis on a law-like world of nature has its correlate in the transference of this to the social order. In effect, you have a regular nature, a regular society, and that actually creates a stable situation. Now, at this point, we might bring in William Paley. And Paley, I think, is a name all of you will know, best known for his 1802 book, Natural Theology, which we could talk about. But I want actually to talk about an earlier work. I want to talk about his Principles of Moral and Political Philosophy, which came out in 1785. And in effect, just became a standard text at Cambridge. Because in this, we see some of Paley's anxieties coming to the fore. And Paley talks about the importance of law as a means of preventing, I quote, perpetual and irremedial anarchy. And really, we're seeing here this anxiety. We want a regular society, which is not going to go and do strange things. We want a regular nature, which is not going to go and do strange things. It's all about ordering. And of course, divine activity in either the social or the natural context, in effect, for Paley, is an eruption, something that's potentially erratic, which is destructive of stability. And you begin to get the impression that Paley is very, very glad that God has created such a wonderful and regular order, and actually, that's it. There is no need for any further divine involvement. And Paley makes the point that the stability of a nation and social order depend on laws, and there's a very clear concern here about the threat from anarchy and lawlessness. And of course, as you will all know, Paley's anxieties were heightened by the French Revolution of 1789, especially the Reign of Terrors, Reign of Terror. And in England at the time, in fact, you know, atheism struggled to cope with this because this was seen as, in effect, implying a link between atheism and anarchy. But Paley himself emphasizes the correlation of laws of science, laws of society, both of which are grounded in the divine nature. And he emphasized this in the idea of contrivance, which is the idea that God doesn't simply design, he creates according to that design, as, for example, one of the great inventors of the Industrial Revolution might construct a telescope or indeed a watch. And his argument is that the world abounds with contrivances, that is, things that are clearly suggestive of design and construction. And these are all directed towards beneficial purposes. Interestingly, Paley affirms the idea of divine providence, as you can see, for example, in this extremely interesting discussion of how divine providence copes with toothache. Teeth are contrived to eat, not to ache. Their aching now and then is incidental to the contrivance, perhaps inseparable from it. Or even, if you will, let it be called a defect in the contrivance, but it's not the object of it. So Paley there has his own way of dealing with the existence of evil in the world. What's interesting is that Paley's notion of divine action is essentially static. It is seen in God's imposition of an order, which is seen in there being a plan for the world, which is to be attributed to the ordination and appointment of an intelligent and designing creator. But the question about what God actually does is rather left unresolved. Paley does not like the idea of a God who interferes, and he's very, very clear that God is benevolent, and that we can talk about a providence, as you can see from this quote. But he's also very, very cagey about how best to actually understand it. Although we believe ever so firmly that there is a providence, we must prepare and provide an act as if there were none. And it's almost as if there is a sort of bifurcation here. We believe in this, but actually there's nothing to see. It doesn't happen. Consistent with a rather static understanding of the way in which the world is set up. And of course, many of you will know that Paley's conception of God was critiqued by many in his own day and age as simply being inconsistent with the Christian idea that God does things. And John Henry Newman is a very good example of a writer like this who, in effect, lambasted Paley as, in effect, presenting English culture with a God who was so unattractive and so disengaged that nobody would be inclined to believe in this God. He wrote that Paley's theology cannot, from the nature of the case, tell us one word about Christianity proper. It can't be Christian in any true sense. In fact, taking men as they are, the so-called science tends, if it occupies the mind, to dispose it against Christianity. So there is an issue there about the whole question of whether this emphasis on the law-likeness of nature creates a disposition against God interfering, Paley's word, because it disrupts the regularity of the world. And that's a theme, I think, that we have to engage with. But we also, I think, need to think about the concept of God that lies behind this. And you saw that beginning to emerge in what John Henry Newman said. I think there is something that's interesting to be said here. The whole rise of deism, a contested word, but an important word, and can be seen as a rationally accommodated notion of God, really designed to maintain the intellectual credibility of Christianity in an increasingly difficult rationalist context. But the standard argument is that the God of deism doesn't actually do anything. Now again, we might want to nuance that, but again, it's the cultural perception that's important. Action in the past, yes, present in activity. I think that this is why I think it's important to begin to bring the Christian doctrine of the Trinity into this discussion. Because in many ways, for patristic writers, the doctrine of the Trinity articulates the notion of a God who is present and acts within the world. But historically, it's very, very clear this doctrine became an embarrassment to senior English churchmen in the 17th and 18th centuries. And it's very easy to identify why this is. First of all, it was seen as being irrational. God is three, God is one. And secondly, it was just quite unclear what benefits this doctrine conferred. And I think the best study of this, as you want to follow through on, is Paul Lim's book, Mystery Unveiled, which is a very comprehensive study of precisely why this doctrine got into such difficulties in early modern England. There are, of course, exceptions. You might think of Jonathan Edwards in the United States in the early 18th century, but interestingly, Edwards' writings dealing so positively with the Trinity are those he didn't intend to publish. It's almost as if these were his private thoughts, which were not meant for the public domain. And we might reflect on what the Trinity is all about. Is the doctrine of the Trinity primarily an affirmation of the inability of human thought to capture or grasp the fullness of God's being? Or is it really about safeguarding the notion of a God who acts? And there's no reason why it shouldn't be both. And we might just look at one example just to make the importance of this point clear. This is Robert Jensen's book, The Triune Identity, which now is quite old, but it makes, I think, some very important points. Jensen's an American Lutheran, but what he says in this book is, at least in my view, neither particularly American nor particularly Lutheran. His point really is, look, the Trinity names a God who acts. In other words, the Trinity is about identifying the moments at which God acts on the stage of human history. The appearances to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the leading of Israel out of exile, out of Egypt through the Exodus into the Promised Land, and of course, for Jensen, the same God is the one who raised Christ from the dead. And the point that Jensen is making is that the Trinity names the God who is at the heart of the Christian faith, who is disclosed in what God actually does. And so for Jensen, the whole doctrine of the Trinity is about a reaffirmation of an active God and the using of these modes of activity as a manner of moving discussion of this God on. So we might ask whether loss of confidence in special divine action contribute to the marginalization of the doctrine, or indeed whether marginalization of the doctrine contribute to this. They're clearly related. It's not clear which is cause, which is effect. It may well be simply two sides of the same coin, but there's some kind of connection here which I think does need to be engaged with. The loss of a concept of God which affirms ongoing divine presence and activity is clearly part of the bigger picture concerning special divine action. And as I think you'll all know, since the First World War, there has been a massive recovery of confidence in the doctrine of the Trinity within mainline Christian theology. Indeed, these days it's actually very, very hard to find a Christian theologian who would kind of way distance himself or herself from this development. Karl Barth clearly played a leading role. We might mention Karl Rahner as well. But this is now very much back on the agenda. I think that this does raise a very interesting question, which is whether this recovery of belief in the doctrine of the Trinity, which is linked with a conceptualization of the activity of God, may actually feed into our discussions about special divine action. It seems to me to be important that there's a reaffirmation of the doctrine's plausibility and utility. And the question then would be how this relates to our discussion. My suggestion simply is that this is a line of inquiry, an angle of approach, which is worth looking at. Going back to Ian Ramsey's book, it's very interesting that he does single out renewed interest in the whole theology of the Holy Spirit as being potentially significant for reopening interest in the whole question of divine activity, and he hints about Pentecostalism as a movement that may have something to say on this matter. And I think, as was mentioned yesterday at one of the presentations, you know, this is part of a changed context. There is at least one version of Christianity which in effect regards special divine action as normal, and we might want to see how that could be brought into this discussion. But I think I want to wrap up now and give my distinguished colleague a chance to come back to explore some of these themes more fully or open up new themes. But it seems to me there are some matters we might reflect on. One of the points I've been trying to emphasize is that we all know there are genuine intellectual issues that need to be engaged, and we're clearly going to be looking at those during this conference. I just want to make the point, it's not just intellectual, there's a cultural backdrop which impacts on the way in which these things are discussed in the media. It impacts on the way in which certain narratives achieve dominance and in effect therefore try to, how should I put it, destabilize or undermine the plausibility of rival narratives, one of which would be a narrative which includes the notion of SDA. And so the question then would be not simply how might one reaffirm the rationality of SDA, but rather how does one change a cultural mindset so that this is seen as being normal or acceptable? Maybe Charles Taylor helps us a little bit, but there's an awful lot more that needs to be done. And I just mentioned three possibilities. There's the whole idea of public intellectuals and a trickle-down effect, whereby, in effect, you know, what the academy thinks today, you know, others will probably think tomorrow, but that has to be communicated, it has to be translated into the ordinary language, and the question is, you know, who's going to be doing this kind of stuff? Antonio Gramsci, of course, emphasized the importance of journalism as a way of changing dominant narratives. C.S. Lewis talked about the importance of telling a better story. I'm just saying that I'm delighted that we're looking at so many of the intellectual issues here, but there is this cultural issue of engaging and challenging a master narrative which simply says this sort of thing doesn't happen. And I think we've got to work out how we deal with that, as well as looking at the various other issues on our agenda. Thank you very much indeed for listening.
Thank you, Alistair. Beautifully lucid presentation. I'm now going to ask Roger to kick off with his response to start our discussion.
Thank you very much, Alistair McGrath, for that really rich presentation of the issues. I can't possibly match the complexity and depth of your thinking about just what hangs on this question of whether special divine action is possible, discernible, and actual, or whether it is none of those three. But as I think you rightly say, there is a huge question here about the cultural mindset which changed people's response to this very possibility. And you end by asking the question, how do we change a cultural mindset? Having devoted my life to this futile endeavor, I would only say that we can't do it from the standpoint of a university lecture hall. What we can do, however, is try and understand the relevance of history to our present circumstances. And I just want to add one thing to what you said. When discussing how this all came about, you mentioned the scientific revolution and the concept of a law-governed universe, which then gradually came to take possession of people's consciousness. I think this made me think about the nature of law and the fact that we're really always in the human heart, there are two ideas of law which are in competition with each other. There is the idea of a discoverable order in things, which exists by nature, by the very nature of those things, and which governs their development and so on, which is the view of law assumed by scientific inquiry, which came into prominence in the 17th and 18th centuries. But then, of course, there's the other view of law, which thunders at us from the Old Testament, of law as a set of commands. Commands which say how things ought to be done, and which perhaps issue from a divine voice. Maybe these two things can come together, but it is interesting that we are now entering a state of conflict between them. The law, as we understand it, especially English-speaking people who have the great gift of the common law in their souls, the law, as we understand it, is something discovered, not something commanded. Whereas, of course, for the Sunni Muslim, law is something commanded. We are seeing, I think, an emerging conflict between these two ideas of law, which could very well tear our civilization apart, as it threatened to do in the 17th century. And you rightly said that in the 16th century, people hesitated to refer or to discuss the Book of Revelation because it seemed to put everything so much on the edge. Things were very different in the 17th century when this country was being torn apart by religious fanaticism and the Whore of Babylon idea was in everybody's consciousness. You know, and I think we're entering a new Whore of Babylon period where people are shouting these imprecations at each other and telling us that God will intervene at any moment and on my side and not on yours. And you said quite rightly that because of the catastrophe of the wars of religion, 30 Years' War, in particular, but also, of course, the civil wars in England and Scotland. Because of that catastrophe, people were pretty well fed up by the end of the 17th century with the idea of law as a system of commands issuing from on high, which could be interrupted by the author of them at any moment. And they were looking for another kind of law, which was, as it were, settled in the very root of things. And the discovery of which would bring peace. Therefore, I think all, as you beautifully describe some of the transformations that occurred as a result of this, that in a sense, people took, if you like, an inquiring attitude to what governs the universe rather than an imploring attitude. Not instead of wishing to immediately summon God to their side, that they humbly wanted to discover what it was that God had created. And I think this, just to conclude my observations, this goes back to something that you said at the beginning, and I think you relate this to Charles Taylor and to Ian Ramsey in particular, that we live at a time when the sense of God's presence in the world is retreating. But I think there are two contrasting ideas of God's presence. One is the idea that he can be summoned into the course of human events so as to change them, which I think is the dangerous idea in many ways. And the other is the idea that we can, as it were, stand back from our own involvement and let his presence dawn on us. And that, funnily enough, has its equivalent in Islam too. I'm no authority on this. Len Goodman, I'm sure, will put me right. But the idea of the Sakina in the Quran is connected with the Mishkan in the Jewish faith, of course. The idea that we can, as it were, put ourselves in God's presence through stilling our own will. That idea, I think, is still available to us and is the source of peace between people and is more connected with that other idea of law, which I think rightly became dominant in the 17th and 18th century. So that's all I have to say, because I'm not a theologian, but just to get the discussion going.
Thank you, Roger, for that very thought-provoking response. In fact, Roger's going to develop some of those ideas in his talk on Wednesday morning about prayer. So it'll be very interesting to see what he has to say. Well, over to you. Could you kindly wait for a microphone? Secondly, could you say who you are? And thirdly, could you make your questions fairly short, just in case there isn't time for my question? So there you go. So we start off with Tim in the front, I think.
Thank you. Tim McGrew, Western Michigan University here. Very interesting and provocative paper, and you were painting with something of a broad brush. And I want to just put in a word for detail in defense of William Paley. You suggested at one point, if I didn't mishear you, that Paley does not like the idea of a God who interferes. That may be an interpretation that Newman picked up from Paley's natural theology. But if you look at some of his other works, like the Evidences, for example, in the preparatory considerations before he even launches into the main argument, he's grappling with Hume and arguing fiercely that there can be both a priori reasons for expecting God to intervene and grounds for saying that he has. So Paley's actually very explicit about that and devotes the beginning of every chapter in the first part of the book has as its heading, there is satisfactory evidence that many professing to be original witnesses of the Christian miracles pass their lives in labors, dangers, and sufferings voluntarily undertaken in attestation of the accounts they delivered and solely in virtue of their belief of those accounts, and that from the same reasons they submitted themselves to new rules of conduct. So he's actually extremely deeply engaged in defending the idea that there are grounds for saying God has intervened. And that has its history going back to Boyle's Christian Virtuoso, where Boyle argues, how can we determine whether a miracle has occurred? The only person who can do so is the person who has devoted some time to seeing what the scope and the limits of nature may be, because it's only then that you can avoid both being duped and being overly cynical. So while I agree about the rise of naturalism, I do just want to stress that there's this strand running through it and even up through Paley himself. And although he's a Cambridge man, I thought that maybe even at Oxford we might be willing to say something on his behalf.
Well, thank you for that. I mean, let me begin by saying I like Paley. I think he's very interesting. And clearly he certainly knew how to live, if I put it like that. But if we look at both natural theology and his Evidences of Christianity, I mean, they're both very, very derivative books, and they're both really picking up on earlier themes. In fact, very often going very, very far back. What I find interesting is this. The apologetic method of those two books are totally different. Now, one of them is, in effect, the whole apologetics of the Evidences of Christianity is based on the assumption its readership is comfortable with the idea of the miraculous. And again, you know, the miraculous is presumed to be propitious for faith. In other words, my readers are going to buy into this, and they will accept this as evidence for Christianity. By the time of natural theology, that's gone. It's a different readership. And, you know, the question is there something that kind of separates these, which helps us understand the change in apologetic method?
Now, those of us who looked at the history of apologetics around this time, in effect, notice a sort of growing reluctance on the part of senior Anglicans, if I can put it like that, to appeal to the miraculous as evidence for Christianity because of a growing cultural disposition against the notion. And my own feeling is that maybe it is right to say that natural theology is the final version, if you like, of the approach, because in effect its approach is almost designed to engage what Schleiermacher might have called the cultural despises of religion. You know, it seems to be pitched to a different audience with a different agenda. And I'm very happy to say there seem to be two Paleys here, one of which is engaging this audience, one is engaging that audience. But my own feeling is the natural theology audience probably is representative of a growing sophisticated lay audience in England at the time. And actually in that audience, I think we see the audience that we're dealing with today. And that's why I just think noticing some of the issues he flags up in that work might help us with our discussions today.
Thank you. Susan.
Thanks very much. Susan Eastman from Duke University. Thanks very much for that talk. I want to pick up on the question of cultural resistance. And I'm also picking up on Roger's comment about a new Whore of Babylon era. I wonder what cultures we have in mind here, because it strikes me, I come from an American context at least, that in popular culture there's huge interest in anything, quote, spiritual. The book of Revelation is extremely popular, people's favorite book. Apocalyptic movies are everywhere. The sense of chaos, the sense of immense hunger for any kind of, quote, spiritual experience, this dominates. And so I wonder if you would want to talk about making a connection. You know, the arguments about rationalism, most folks I know are not interested in rational discourse. They're interested in sound bites, experience, imaginative connections to God any way they can find it, and so forth. I wonder if you would talk about sort of the concerns you've raised in that cultural context.
Well, I'll say something, and then I'm sure Roger will follow through with something much better. I think using the word culture is dangerous, because there isn't culture, there's a multiplicity of cultures. And in many ways, I'm reflecting the kind of intellectual culture I'm engaging with, because that's kind of the conversation I'm having. And that's what I come up against. You're absolutely right that there are myriads of cultures, and for some of them, this issue presents no difficulty at all. In fact, the question would be, why are you talking about this? I mean, it's like asking, why is the sky blue? This is the way things are. And I think that is actually a very important point to make, that actually the available believable, if I can use that phrase, varies enormously from one culture to another. I think that the agenda set by this conference is a very wise agenda. It's saying, look, in effect, there may be some people who have no problems with this at all. Well, that's great. But for others, there are these issues, and it's therefore good to talk about them in their most pointed form, in the forms in which there are genuine intellectual and cultural issues which are of a negative type. So, in effect, we can figure out what can be said in both contexts. But I know exactly what you mean, I know some of these communities, and I've sat and listened to the discourse about divine action in these communities and watched the language being used, and also the use to which it's put. And it's miles away from what I was talking about. But I felt we had to pitch this at, well, if I use the word optimal, that's a very, very evaluative term. What I'm saying is, we've got to go for where the criticism is. That's how you move ahead on these things. And I know, like you, that there are communities where this is just bread and butter. This is just the way things are. I think we've got to make sure we can engage those communities where this is actually completely contrary to the dominant narrative, because that narrative actually, in my view, is influential and actually is likely to get more influential, certainly here in the United Kingdom. And therefore, asking the cultural question, I think, is just very, very important, alongside the very good intellectual questions that are being asked as well.
Roger.
Well, I agree with Susan Eason's question that there isn't one culture that characterizes all of our civilization, but we do tend to distinguish the self-conscious and intellectual part of it as though that's where everything important is happening, because after all, that it justifies the absurd salaries that most people in this room are paid. But it is the rest which matters, and the rest is pretty horrendous, as always, because humanity is pretty horrendous. I think that it is different in America, where you have constant small groups of religious revivalists who tend to pick on those things like the Book of Revelation, the signs of God's presence, God's active presence in history and in the present events. Here it is rather different, I think one of the most interesting lessons for a visitor is to listen to the evensong, Anglican evensong on Radio 3, where it's usually done according to the old Book of Common Prayer, and you just hear the soporific sounds of that old, melancholy English sense of the hopelessness of everything. You know, and then you know that religion has a different form.
Yeah. Right. Sorry. Then the gentleman in the third row. Well, two, yes, okay. Just first. And I will go towards the back in due course.
Just one synthetic or ironic suggestion I would make, that these two cultures, although they may not be in fruitful dialogue with one another, play off each other, interact against each other. I think that one of the principal sources of that spirituality that Susan so rightly refers to and that we have all observed, and indeed of Islamic fundamentalism, and indeed of many other forms of religious extremes, is set off and very conscientiously reacting against. We don't want that kind of anarchy, as Dr. McGrath has put it. We don't want that kind of anarchy in our lives. We don't want it in our children. How many people have I met whose children are more observant, more spiritual, more religious, whose religiosity has taken a violently different form? How many analytic philosophers do we know whose children have become Buddhists or Hare Krishnas or what have you, or Christian theologians? We could all name names. Or people who in their own spiritual odysseys have reacted against that disenchantment or disengagement that Taylor and Max Weber described by consciously seeking out and pursuing, whether it's the Trinity or whether it's shaving their heads or whatever they have done. These two cultures are in communication with each other, and I think that that communication is not always constructive. I think one of the great benefits of a conference like this one is to open up the channels of communication, which would enable us, intellectually at least, to make it possible to mediate, to translate, to conciliate, and to moderate those trends which set off those extremes.
I'd like to respond to that. Alister or Roger?
Well, I think you're right. I mean, if I could just amplify a bit further, I mean, sometimes the debate is simply framed in terms of, you know, there's this culture which thinks this culture thinks that, and I'm not them. In other words, you're in effect almost exercising it by saying, you know, that to think that is to belong to them and I'm not one of them. It's a very dichotomous way of thinking, but it happens. And that's why I think it's so important to try and disentangle the issues from the cultures while recognizing that we can't get away from cultural issues. So at some point we have to go back and look at that one, but for the moment we can stand back from that, and that's what's so great.
Daniel von Wachter, International Academy of Philosophy in the Principality of Liechtenstein. I thought you presented the process towards anti-interventionism as a rather rational one, as a rather broad one. And I'm inclined to think it was a less rational one and a not so broad one, so rather a propaganda success of a relatively small group. One example, you indicated that there was, for example, increasing belief that there are natural causes and that they're acting on themselves or something like that. Well, Christians had always believed in causa secunda, in secondary causes. You mentioned scientific revolution, where the processes, the methods of the natural sciences had been developed from the 13th century, probably. I don't see these kinds of causes. But I do see that there was a rather small group getting good propaganda success, and it was even helped by the government. For example, in Prussia, where much of that took place in a rather clear form from 1740, more or less. In 1775, the minister von Zedlitz forbade the teaching of the philosophy of Christian August Crusius and promoted more Kantian, more deterministic philosophers. So, and the whole process, if we dig deeper, we find that there is very articulate thought spelling out a more traditional interventionist picture of divine action and so on, and you find very vocal, small groups, more on the journalistic level and on the government level. So therefore, I think it was more a propaganda success than a rational and a broad process.
Well, I think the reason I appealed to Charles Taylor is that the puzzle I was trying to engage with is, you know, we have this narrative, which in my view is perfectly acceptable, which I see in Thomas Aquinas, I see in various other writers. And then I see this rather different narrative, and the other narrative wins, put it very, very crudely. And I want to know how it won. And the point I'm making is that actually that there are sociological factors involved in this. It's not just sort of the intellectual assessment of two rival narratives. There's a question of who's in power, who's in a position to influence, who generates the journals that everyone reads. It's these kind of things. And the reason I'm asking that question is because if we want to try and undo that, we've got to understand the process by which it happened in the first place. And my own feeling is that actually we're in quite a good place to reopen these questions, because there is actually, at least in my view, and this is a terribly subjective view, a certain weariness with the hitherto dominant narrative and perhaps a receptivity towards alternatives. I read Roger's recent book, The Soul of the World, and I have to say that's the kind of book I think that might move the discussion on, because you know he's really articulating to my way, is quite an attractive way of looking at things, but in a very winsome way, in a very what the right word is, sort of elegant rhetoric that drags you along because you like where it's going, and as you go along, you begin thinking that needs to be taken seriously. So you know, I think there are things that can be done, but the reason that I chose to highlight this issue, how did this narrative win out over that one when the other one actually is quite good, is actually it's not simply intellectual. There's something else going on, and if we want to move the discussion on, we need to figure out how we identify that something else and actually use that to move things on.
Any comment, Roger, from the winsome but rigorous press group?
Very good. No, I like that. Very nice picture on the cover as well.
No, that's all I needed to hear.
Thank you. Now, we've only got 10 minutes left for discussion. I have an epidemic of upper limbs. I'm going to park up my question as a gift to the people. So, so could we have very short questions and slightly less short answers? So, there's a gentleman who's got the conch at the moment. Yes, thank you.
Doug McGahey from Willamette University in Salem, Oregon. I'm concerned that this conversation is getting formulated in terms of traditional metaphysics, and that we're giving a simplistic alternative between mechanical empirical metaphysics and a teleological form of metaphysics. And I like to remind myself and my students that what happened in the Copernican Revolution was not the discovery of laws of this movement of the Earth, but rather it is a construction of human beings, the only species capable of denying its senses to say that the Earth is moving and that the sun is standing still, and that this so-called mechanical law is we don't create that system, but we create the understanding of it. There is no law without our creative contribution to grasping it. The same is true of the civic law, that the civic law is only the product of human creativity. And that if we only make the option, though, of mechanical explanation or divine action by means of a teleological intervention into the world, then we're leaving the crucial role of humanity out of the picture, that doesn't have to collapse into secular humanism, because humanity is dependent upon conditions not of its own creation, and it's also, though, responsible for its creative contribution to the understanding of the world. And so I'm wondering if there's not a third option that we need to consider that is beyond mechanical determinism and teleological intervention.
Well, I'm sure there is. I mean, I think the point I particularly appreciate you making is that there's a danger that we imprison the universe in a rationality that's of our own invention, rather than trying to discover the rationality that actually underlies the universe. And so I think that your point about the laws of nature is good. You know, we need to we need to try not to impose this on nature, but rather try and discern what is going on in nature, and then trying to make mental adjustments to whatever we think after that. And that seems to me to be a very important part of the scientific method.
Fine. I think the gentleman had his hand up earlier on, and then I'm sorry to, I'm going to have to, may well not pick up all the questions.
Andrew Briggs, so to be quick, I was wondering if in the different cultural influences that you talk about, particularly in more recent years, one should include and address the cultural influence of science and engineering. And I suppose in the last 50 years it's had a bumpy ride, but first of all, the sciences and the physical sciences, as much as the life sciences, have changed the way we live. And second, they seem to have provided the scientific methods seem to provide a criterion for explanation. And both of these seem to be quite effective without the need to invoke special divine action or even God at all to many people. And so my question is, where you talk about engaging with the culture for reasons that I recognize, I'm wondering if there's also scope for taking an initiative and a science-driven initiative, in the sense that there are many new issues coming up in science, many cases where rapid progress is being made, where one can seize the initiative to take those and use them to be on the front foot in this kind of engagement.
I'm very sympathetic to that. I think the answer is yes, but I think the more difficult question is how do we do this? And I think that the point you made is a very good one, and raises the critical question of who is it that's interpreting science to our culture? Because actually, it's hard. You know, someone's got to actually explain this, and in explaining it, they're interpreting it, and they're providing their own spin on it. And I think that it really highlights the importance of science correspondence, popular science writers. We might mention one name, but you've suggested we don't mention the D word here. But you know, the point really, I think, is that we do need to think about who might be able to recalibrate the debate in an accessible way, because that's how perceptions get changed. And I that's just a lingering question. We've got to come back to it. Can't ignore it.
Thank you.
Roger, any comment on that?
No, yes, I agree with what Alister said. Yeah.
We've got probably time for two shortish questions, so I've got to choose people at random. The gentleman with the beard and the glasses and the very nice check shirt.
Very quick. So I want to see what you say in response to this. It seems that there's an assumption behind your talk that might be incompatible with the assumption of a number of people in the room, and that is that science is compatible with religion. Because it seems on the one hand you think that religion requires divine intervention. You had some quotes in there about if you don't have divine intervention, then it's not compatible with Christianity, right? On the other hand, you seem to be suggesting that if we have this, the scientific worldview, if we have the scientific worldview that is dominant in the culture, there's just no way to make an argument for miracles in that culture. We have to dial that back and instead emphasize something else if we're going to have an argument for that, right? And so it seems that you seem to be thinking that if there's science has got, if science has today and that's the dominant culture, we're not going to be able to have an argument for miracles in that. So it would be pointless to try to present any kind of scientific argument for miracles, whether it be based in Bayes or whatever. You have to do something else. You have to be doing something else with that. And that seems to be incompatible with what a number of people would assume is that the science and religion are compatible. So I wonder if you could speak to that.
Yes, well, I clearly have not spoken well, because that's not what I think at all. I think that what I was trying to do in that talk was to indicate that that this whole debate is being framed in terms of certain narratives, and that in effect that is one of the reasons why it's very difficult to have this dialogue between science and religion, because very often that those are positioned and defined by dominant narratives. I don't see any difficulty here at all, but then I just don't buy into that master narrative at all. I think it's wrong. My issue is, you know, how do we try and get it reevaluated? What do we need to do to have that done? So I would be puzzled, I have to say, if I thought you drew the conclusion from my talk that I was somehow saying that science and religion are incompatible. I mean, for me, I think Newton raised a very, very important point, which is, if a miraculous thing happens regularly, does that cease being a miracle? And I think that's a very interesting point to go away and think about. because, you know, it seems to me it flags up an issue that I suspect we're going to come back to at several points in this discussion.
Time for one final question. Lady there, yes, thank you, and the white bias.
Thank you very much for your talk. Bethany Soleretter from Exeter University. I was struck by both you and Graham Twelfthree yesterday talking about the influence of Pentecostalism, and I was wondering if that sort of a movement actually offers us a fourth model of cultural change in terms of grassroots change, Little Bible College, Topeka, Kansas, you know, and then LA. But its global impact has been far larger than the D word. Is that another viable option?
Well, the short answer is I think it is. But because I am neither a Pentecostal nor someone who knows very much about Pentecostalism, I felt it was inappropriate to develop it further. But certainly, one of the things that you might say is, look, we've talked about narratives, okay? Pentecostalism has this narrative, and it is a narrative in which there is an expectation that God will act. It will act, you will act in individual life, will act in the world, and that, in effect, generates a plausibility structure which causes you to expect this sort of thing and to read certain things in certain ways, and is a very different way of looking at things. And it is, as you rightly point out, I mean, a very, very large number of people think in this way. And the idea of special divine action is almost routinized. You know, I don't in any way want to be critical of this, but it's a different way of looking at things completely. And it's clearly very, very attractive for a lot of people. It's clearly growing. And it clearly has implications for the discussion of our agenda. So all I can say is yes, I think it does very, very much. But I'm not the right person to talk about, I'm afraid.
Well, on that note, alas, we've reached 90 minutes full time, heading towards injury time. But just remains me to thank both Alister and Roger for a very rich talk.